God, and welcome once again to Daily Manna, this featured presentation brought to you each day by St. Mark, located right here in Orlando, Florida. I am just humbly honored to have the opportunity to continue our discussion of 1 Corinthians, and we're in chapter now number 3, and I'm excited that we're at verse number 16, and we're going to go down through verse number 23. Listen to God's word as God speaks to us. Don't you know that you yourselves are God's temple? Listen to that. I like how this boy writes. And that God's spirit lives in you. If anyone destroys God's temple, God will destroy him. For God's temple is sacred, and you are that temple. Do not deceive yourselves. If any of you thinks he is wise by the standards of this age, he should become a fool so that he may become wise. For the wisdom of the world is foolishness in God's sight, as it is written. He catches the wise in their craftiness. And again, the Lord knows that the thoughts of the wise are futile. So then, no more boasting about men. All things are yours, whether Paul or Apollos or Cephas, or the world or life or death or the present or the future, all are yours. And you are of Christ, and Christ is of God. I mean, when you look at what Paul does in this chapter as he's dealing with this whole issue of the quarreling and the debate that is a result of jealousy between Cephas, between Paul and Apollos, and the people trying to determine who's connected to who. And you get to this point coming through this wonderful chapter, you have to say, oh, wow, this brother was really writing. Remember, Paul has taken the time to remind us the objective of the believer is to please God. In pleasing God, we are attempting to build bridges and not barriers. And people who have come to know the foundation upon which we stand is not Paul, is not Cephas, is not Apollos, but Jesus Christ. And what we do is we recognize that that foundation is the foundation upon which we are built, and the building is erected by the grace that has been given to us. And we are all workers together in it. And so Paul takes the time to then say to the people, you are the temple. In essence, he says, what we're erecting is Christ's church, the body of Christ, and you are the temple. What we're trying to erect are new sanctuaries. You are that sanctuary. Don't you know that song? Lord, prepare me to be a sanctuary, pure and holy, tried and true. And with thanksgiving, I'm willing to be a sanctuary just for you. You are aware that later on inside of this same 1 Corinthians, Paul reminds us that we are the temple of the Holy Spirit, and that we're not our own, but we are also of Christ. We have been bought with a price. He goes right back to that. So Paul takes the time right now to try to link together his whole argument. You as a temple cannot be destroyed. And when you're fighting against each other, you're warring against each other. And the war is against that which is God's. And each of you are sacred in God's sight. And God ultimately gets in the fight and will destroy anything that's fighting against that which is supposed to be God's representative. If I am God's representative in the earth, then for you to fight against me means destruction is your end. Why? Because God comes to fight for God's own. Look in Scripture. You can't tell me a time that God does not come to the aid of what God has established. Every time God comes to therefore be the one who stands in between the enemy and that which belonged to God. Because God was clear to say, you can't touch mine. As a matter of fact, it was clear, I think, that it was David that said these words about Saul, when even though Saul was trying to kill him, and that moment when Saul's life sat in the balance and David could have taken Saul's life, he says out of his own mouth to his own army, hiding in the cave, who perceived that Saul being where he was God putting their enemy in his hands. And David says, touch not thine anointed, and do my prophet no harm, is what God says. And so clearly David reminds us that that which belongs to God is God's. I got to ask you, do you believe that you belong to God? Have you ever heard the terminology namaste? Well, that terminology means that I salute the God in you. The God in me salutes the God in you. I acknowledge that God is a part of you and that God is within you. Namaste. And so somewhere along the line, we have become so Baptist that we have forgotten we're Christian. We've become so Methodist, we've forgotten we're Christian. We've become so Presbyterian, we've forgotten we're Christian. We've become so Lutheran, we've forgotten we're Christian. We've become so Kojic, we've forgotten we're Christian. We've become so full gospel Baptist, we've forgotten we're Christian. We've become so evangelical, we've forgotten we're Christians. In some kind of way, God is calling us to renew our understanding of our witness. So that when we begin walking around trying to act like we're smart, Paul says, stop doing that. Go ahead and act more foolish. Because God confounds that which is the wisdom of the world. They think they're smart. And too many of us think we're too smart. And in all honesty, what we consider to be intelligence is nothing but foolishness in the sight of God. And when we are foolish, we are wise in God's sight. Remember, Paul will later tell us that God has taken the foolishness of preaching to save that which is lost. It makes no sense for somebody to be talking about someone who hung on a cursed tree and died. And for that person to be resurrected, and through the resurrection of that entity, humanity has been saved. It makes no logical sense. It is something that many play down. But in all honesty, I am saved because he was willing to be the gift that I could not give, to offer a life that I could not provide, and to pay a ransom that I could never, ever pay. And I'm thankful today that I am saved by his power divine, saved to new life sublime. Life now is sweet, and my soul is complete because I am saved. So therefore, any of my boasting about what denomination I'm connected to or what link by which I have come to know Christ is futile and should not be done, because I should not be boasting solely about my attachment to human allegiance. I should be bragging about the God who gave me his son that through him I might be saved. Do you not hear the song? I hear it so loud. It sings, it sounds so sweet in my ears. How to reach the masses, those of every birth? For an answer, Jesus gave the key. And if I be lifted up from the earth, I'll draw all people unto me. Oh, the world is hungry for the living bread. Lift the Savior up for them to see. Trust him and do not doubt the words that he said. I'll draw all men unto me. If we can just take the time to lift Jesus to the people and show the people how he has made a difference in our lives by graciously looking beyond our faults, then people can then stop hearing what divides us, but can see what brings us together. It's not my denomination. It's not my preacher. It's not my pastor. It's not my elder. It's not my bishop. But it's him, the Lord. And we all need to lift him up. I hope as we've studied this chapter, you see that Paul begs us to please God enough to build bridges and not barriers, so that we together might be on the foundation of Jesus Christ that has been graciously given to us, who now we now represent, not based on our thoughts of what the scripture says, but on what the scripture really says about him, that allows us to see the necessity to live Christ, not our denominations, not our preachers, not our people, but to live Christ, and in so doing, he'll draw all people unto himself. Once again, I'm not out of word, I'm just out of time, but I'm thankful for your time, and I do look forward to our coming together again tomorrow. Until then, God bless.